Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming? And the rocket's red glare, the bomb bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
On the shore, dimly seen through the mists, the deep, where the foe's haughty host in dread silence reposes, what is that which the breeze o'er the towering steep as it fitfully blows, half conceals, half discloses? Now it catches the gleam of the morning's first beam, in full glory reflected now shines on the stream. 'Tis the star-spangled banner, oh, long may it wave over the land of the free, the home of the brave.
'Tis the star-spangled banner, oh, long may it wave over the land of the free,
and the home of the brave. And where is that band who so vauntingly swore that the havoc of war and the battle's confusion, a home and a country should leave us no more? Their blood has washed out their foul footsteps' pollution. No refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight or the gloom of the grave. And the star-spangled banner in triumph doth wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
O'er the land of the free
and the home of the brave.
Oh, thus be it ever when freemen shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us, a nation. And then conquer we must, when our cause it is just, and this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free, the home of the brave.
Then conquer we must, when our cause it is just, and this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
End of poem.
Hello and welcome to the Whistling Podcast. My name is Blake Bogle. Today's podcast will be slightly different than usual in that it's not directly about whistling, but indirectly about whistling. This is another article written by Noel Coppage, who is the author of The Vanishing Art of Whistling, which I find to be the best article written on the history of whistling that I've found so far. So there's quite a few reasons why I wanted to read this article into the record. First one, of course, as I just said, was that Noel Coppage, the writer of this article, also wrote The Vanishing Art of Whistling. Hirt Chatru won the world whistling competition in the movie Pucker Up, with sort of a dirty trick playing on the patriotism of the judges by whistling the Star-Spangled Banner.
Thank you.
There will be a discussion of Pucker Up sometime in the future. 1931, the year that the Star Spangled Banner became our national anthem, was also the year in which Charles Gray Shaw called Whistlers. Chris Ullman, another world champion whistler, seems to be a guest whistler of the Star Spangled Banner at sporting events, at least during the time when he was on top. Also, our opening reading of the Star Spangled Banner was done by Bing Crosby, one of the great whistlers and maybe my favorite. When I was going to college, I had to read Breakfast of Champions by Kurt Vonnegut for one of my English classes, and if you've ever read that novel of his, you'll know that in the beginning he talks about our Star Spangled Banner, saying that it's pure balderdash, and the only national anthem that's gibberish sprinkled with question marks. I don't know if Noel Coppage read Breakfast of Champions. I think Breakfast of Champions came out after his article, but his thesis seems to be the same, that maybe the Star Spangled Banner is not the best song to represent our nation. Colin Kaepernick is not in the news anymore, but the question still stands, is this the song we want to be our national anthem? I'll let Noel Coppage make the case. Say, Can You Sing the Star-Spangled Banner by Noel Coppage. Low camp can be entertaining in its way, but not for very long. The best of it, if best there is, palls after a month or so. Who could stand to watch Andy Hardy movies for 10 years, for example? Mercifully, most low camp dies right on schedule the minute it becomes a bore. But there are exceptions. The most blatant of these is the national anthem of the United States of America. Few Americans escape exposure to the Star Spangled Banner in some form for more than a week at a time in their daily lives, since they are always turning up at events where it is played, especially sports events. But The Old Air with Words by Francis Scott Key is now having additional attention focused on it by the reissue of Oscar George Theodore Sonnick's book, The Star-Spangled Banner, by DeCapo Press. This intricate piece of research was first printed in 1914 by the Government Printing Office. Mr. Sonnick at the time was chief of the Division of Music at the Library of Congress. The year 1914 was, of course, the year in which the Star-Spangled Banner reached its 100th birthday. Mr. Sonnick's book is the authority on the construction of the national anthem, and in it he came down hard on shoddy research by his predecessors, who had produced several wild, wonderful, and inaccurate accounts of how the words and music were created and merged to become the Star-Spangled Banner. Mr. Sonnick did not presume to be as critical about the words and music, however. A pity. As a music lover, I could forgive sloppy researchers' sins by the carload before I would get around to condoning, by silence or otherwise, what Mr. Key has done to us. The Star-Spangled Banner can be described as uniquely American, particularly by anyone who dislikes Americans. It does reflect our generally undiscriminating taste in music, our willingness to accept practically any scramble of words as poetry, our seeming fixation on war and violence, and it is the epitome of the uniquely American knack for turning out unintentional irony on a grand scale, outranking even our station wagons in that department. Unintentional irony is an element of camp, of course, and the Star-Spangled Banner is gorged with it. We stole the melody from the British at a time when we were at war with the British. The melody had been written for a British social club and fitted to a song called To Anacreon in Heaven.
Besides, I'll instruct you like me to entwine the myrtle of Venus with a Bacchus and vine.
And besides, I'll instruct you like me to entwine the myrtle.
Anacreon was a Greek poet of the 6th century BC, noted for his light and graceful lyrics, and for his exaltations of women and wine. In short, the melody for our war-hawking theme song was supposed to honor a man who, if ever a man did, believed in making love, not war. But stealing a melody, and stealing a peacenik melody, and stealing it from the enemy weren't enough for Key. No, he had to steal a bad melody, one that covers an octave and a fifth, arrange Vic Damone and Bob Goulet, have a hell of a time with, and Aretha Franklin found downright freaky at the 1968 Democratic National Convention.
CBS News color coverage of Campaign 68, the Democratic National Convention in Chicago, will continue in a moment.
Another pop singer, Jose Feliciano, who should have known better by then, did his thing with the Star-Spangled Banner at a World Series game, drawing outraged cries from a few squares, shrieks from a few teeny boppers, and yawns from the rest of us.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. Please rise and join in the singing of our national anthem, which will be played by Merle Albee's band and will be sung by Jose Feliciano.
America, with no great operatic tradition, has a theme song its best singers are afraid to sing in public. Perhaps it doesn't scare Maria Callas, but then few things seem to. That the melody was also patently ridiculous in a song celebrating the lifestyle of a swinger like Anacreon gives us little comfort. We're not talking relatively when we cast about for a national anthem. If the Anacreontic Society is willing to settle for second-rate stuff, that's their business. But we have all those people out there, and they deserve better. America is lively, industrious, optimistic, irreverent, careless, tender, cantankerous, and friendly. The Star-Spangled Banner melody is only somber, pompous, and cumbersome, three properties seldom found in the American spirit. But considering the words Key fitted to the melody, it is perhaps not surprising that he chose it. We also might consider momentarily some evidence, not conclusive, mind you, turned up by Mr. Sonic, that Key was tone-deaf. Some who knew Key claimed he had trouble recognizing the Star-Spangled Banner every time he heard it played without the words. One acquaintance even said that Key's daughter, granddaughter, and great-granddaughter inherited this tin ear. They couldn't recognize the danged thing either. The average baseball crowd never hears the second, third, and fourth verses of the Star-Spangled Banner, nor does it see them printed on the stadium's message board, perhaps because the carnage they evoke is even more upsetting than soul singers' versions of the song. The first stanza is bad enough, full of rockets glaring and bombs bursting, but the median is the message, to paraphrase Marshall McLuhan and make a tiny pun. The middle verses contain the meat of Key's legacy.
On the shore, dimly seen through the mists of the deep, where the foe's haughty host in dread silence reposes,
begins the second verse, and it goes on to commit such literary atrocities as the towering steep and the morning's first beam. Who comes to mind when bad writing is mentioned? Joyce Kilmer, Edgar A. Guest, Longfellow, they all wrote better than that. In fact, and time will bear this out, Khalil Gibran could write better than that if he put his mind to it. If James Fenimore Cooper could, anybody can. All right. The second verse is poorly written, but it is merely poorly written flag-waving. What about the third?
And where is that band who so vauntingly swore that the havoc of war and the battle's confusion, a home and a country, should leave us no more? The blood has washed out their foul footsteps' pollution. No refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight and the gloom of the grave,
etc. The fourth verse cites this as the heaven-rescued land and justifies it all with conquer we must when our cause it is just. Such a glorification of the screaming eagle could only have been written during a war, as of course it was. But not just any war. Leave it to Key. He chose to write during the War of 1812. Only war he had, I suppose. By far the most ridiculous war of modern history. Key was in fact on board a British vessel, or on board his own cartel ship tied up next to it, when he wrote the first words, on the back of an envelope, if you please.
In the War of 1812, which was fought for the freedom of the seas, the British attacked Baltimore, which was guarded by Fort McHenry. Francis Scott Key was a prisoner of war on one of the British battleships while they bombarded the fort for a day and a night. By the flash of the guns, he saw our flag waving over the fort, and in the morning he found that our flag was still there. He was so proud that our flag had survived this awful bombardment that he wrote the words of the Star Spangled Banner on the back of an old letter he had in his pocket. It was many years later that Congress adopted the Star Spangled Banner as the national anthem of the United States. He tried to see by rocket glare if the stars and stripes were there. He paced the deck throughout the night, waiting for the morning light. Through shot and shell and rocket flame, our flag was there when morning came. Francis Scott Key was inspired to write the Star-Spangled Banner that night.
This war, which Key couldn't wait to capture in verse, had started over a British blockade that had already been lifted when America declared war. Its most famous battle, the rout of the British at New Orleans by Kentucky possum hunters, abetted by the pirate Jean Lafitte, took place after the peace treaty had been signed. It was, particularly for any such who find some glory in warfare, a war best forgotten. Even as Key started his poem, the British fleet found its rockets and bombs, actually artillery shells, were dropping short because it couldn't get close enough to Baltimore. Chesapeake Bay was full of sunken ships and couldn't be navigated. The whole episode was a boggle from start to finish. Nevertheless, from it we took our national anthem. See comments about unintentional irony above. Key, we find, was on a British ship the night of September 13th to 14th, 1814, because he had been asked to negotiate the release of a friend held by the British Navy. Since the bombardment was about to start, the British thought it wise to keep him in sight, and so he was, either on the ship or under guard on the U.S. diplomatic cartel alongside, through the night, which he presumably spent watching over the ramparts. He finished the poem, remember now how much more militant it is in the last two verses, in the relative safety of the Fountain Inn in Baltimore. Tone deaf or not, Key probably had the Anacreon melody in mind at the time. At any rate, words and music soon appeared together, and Mr. Sonic, at least, is satisfied that Key put them together himself. The melody had by then undergone many indignities, having been adapted by Thomas Paine as a campaign song for John Adams, Adams and Liberty.
Let fame to the world sound America's voice. No intrigue can her sons from the government sever. For her pride is John Adams, his laws are her choice, and she'll flourish till liberty slumbers forever. Then unite heart in hand, like Leonidas's band, and swear to the God of ocean and land that ne'er shall the sons of Columbia be slaves while the earth bears a plant and the sea rolls a wave.
Which, as campaign songs go, has to rank somewhere below Hello Linden, and having been used for several sets of drinking song lyrics, it had also been used once before by Key in the predictably militaristic The Warrior's Return.
When the warrior returns from the battle afar, to the home and the country nobly defended, oh, warm be the welcome to gladden his ear, and loud be the joy that his perils are ended. In the full tide of song, let his fame roll along.
The melody was originally written by John Stafford Smith for the Anacreontic Society of London, and matched to a set of lyrics written by the Society's president, Ralph Tomlinson, about 1780. In the original version, the closing couplet for each verse called not for flags to wave, but for people to entwine the myrtle of Venus with Bacchus's vine.
And besides, I'll instruct you like me to entwine the myrtle of Venus with Bacchus's vine.
And besides, I'll instruct you like me to entwine the myrtle.
Mr. Tomlinson, like Anacreon before him, had definite ideas about how symbolism ought to be used in a song. Unfortunately, like Key after him, he was lousy at picking melodies, and not too good at fitting lyrics to the ones he picked. After a long, slow climb up the charts to become the country's ultimate, at least some thought so, patriotic ditty, the Star-Spangled Banner was adopted in 1931 as our national anthem, becoming yet another milestone in the Hoover administration. The national anthem did not come to us from a divine hand, however, but was given its status by an act of Congress, a body known to change its mind occasionally, and it was given that status during the dreary heart of the Depression, when many congressmen probably weren't concentrating very hard on such things as national songs. The choice of the Star-Spangled Banner over other songs was purely arbitrary. Admittedly, it may have been a popular choice when it was made, but it need not be one we are stuck with to eternity. There is nothing un-American about changing the national anthem or changing any other act of Congress. We survived the repeal of Prohibition, and that wasn't merely an act of Congress, but a constitutional amendment. While the evidence doesn't exactly support Franklin D. Roosevelt's statement that the United States does not like war, since Key wrote the Star-Spangled Banner, the country has dabbled in war almost continuously and has reached a pinnacle of sorts at which the military accounts for more than half of the national budget. It is nevertheless difficult to believe that we really want to be so barefaced about liking war as to go around singing, "Their blood has washed out their foul footsteps pollution." The leader of the free world, as it calls itself, does not look for trouble, does it? I'll rephrase that. The people of the United States, discounting whatever foreign policy morass their elected representatives may be sinking into at the moment, do not go around spoiling for a fight, do they? Is success on the battlefield the only picture of America we care to transmit? There is precious little else transmitted by our national anthem. We could and do boast in song about our Purple Mountain majesties, our redwood forests and Gulf Stream waters, our sweet land of liberty, and our lullaby of Broadway, but none of these gets mention in our national anthem. There is no reason why we cannot scrap the Star-Spangled Banner and replace it with some more accurate description, something about a big-hearted, hard-working nation with its share of bungling father figures and crabgrass problems, a nation that is showing signs of putting aside its violent past and taking up sex and computer programming, a place where the door handles fall off brand new station wagons, but where one can get freeze-dried coffee and a full day's supply of vitamins and a bowl of cereal, even if he uses skimmed milk. No reason why the inhabitants of the leader of the free world should be ashamed to have the words of their national anthem flashed on the scoreboard at Yankee Stadium. If we had a new national anthem, one that accurately described America and its aspirations, we still would face the prospect of having it thought campy. Anything can become camp, since there's no ceiling on the sophistication of camp followers. But low camp is something else. The next national anthem that slips into that bracket won't stay there for 40 years. I hope you found that article interesting. I'm considering having a follow-up podcast to discuss the possible replacements for the Star Spangled Banner. There's about 10 songs in contention. I tried to get through the Sonic book about the Star Spangled Banner, but I just couldn't do it. It was just too tedious and dry for me. But I think this article is sufficient to give you a good history of where the Star Spangled Banner came from. As far as my history with the Star Spangled Banner, I played in school band from 6th grade through university, and I've probably played the Star Spangled Banner at least 1,000 times, if not more. But being a clarinet player, I never had to sing it, so I've never really known the lyrics past the first verse. Thank you for listening today, and next week we'll be back on track with an article by Hillel Schwartz called Whistling for the Hell of It. This article may be my new favorite article on whistling. Since Noel Coppage mentioned some bad writers in the article, Joyce Kilmer, Edgar A. Guest, Longfellow, and Khalil Gibran, I'll leave you with a poem by each of them. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you next time on the Whistling Podcast. You can join the Whistling Podcast group on Facebook. I now have a website, thewhistlingpodcast.com. You can support the show on Patreon at patreon.com/thewhistlingpodcast. And I also have a Quora site for discussions, thewhistlingpodcastspace.quora.com. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you next time on The Whistling Podcast.
Trees by Joyce Kilmer, read for LibriVox.org by Brian. I think that I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree. A tree whose hungry mouth is pressed against the earth's sweet flowing breast. A tree that looks at God all day and lifts her leafy arms to pray. A tree that may in summer wear a nest of robins in her hair, upon whose bosom snow has lain, who intimately lives with rain. Poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree.
It Couldn't Be Done by Edgar A. Guest, read for LibriVox.org by Brian Van Vliet. Somebody said that it couldn't be done, but he with a chuckle replied that maybe it couldn't, but he would be one who wouldn't say so till he'd tried. So he buckled right in, with a trace of a grin on his face. If he worried, he hid it. He started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. Somebody scoffed, "Oh, you'll never do that, at least no one ever has done it." But he took off his coat, and he took off his hat, and the first thing we knew, he'd begun it. With a lift of his chin and a bit of a grin, without any doubting or quiddit, He started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. There are thousands to tell you it cannot be done. There are thousands to prophesy failure. There are thousands to point out to you one by one the dangers that wait to assail you. But just buckle in with a bit of a grin. Just take off your coat and go to it. Just start in to sing as you tackle the thing that cannot be done, and you'll do it.
The Dying Man and the Vulture by Khalil Gibran. Read for LibriVox.org by Elizabeth Klett. Wait, wait yet a while, my eager friend. I shall yield but too soon this wasted thing, whose agony overwrought and useless exhausts your patience. I would not have your honest hunger wait upon these moments. But this chain, though made of a breath, is hard to break, and the will to die, stronger than all things strong, is stayed by a will to live, feebler than all things feeble. Forgive me, comrade, I tarry too long. It is memory that holds my spirit, a procession of distant days, a vision of youth spent in a dream, a face that bids my eyelids not to sleep, a voice that lingers in my ears, a hand that touches my hand. Forgive me that you have waited too long. It is over now, and all is faded. The face, the voice, the hand, and the mist that brought them hither. The knot is untied. The cord is cleaved. And that which is neither food nor drink is withdrawn. Approach, my hungry comrade. The board is made ready, and the fare, frugal and spare, is given with love. Come, and dig your beak here, into the left side, and tear out of its cage this smaller bird whose wings can beat no more. I would have it soar with you into the sky. Come now, my friend. I am your host tonight, and you my welcome guest.
Paul Revere's Ride by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Read for LibriVox.org by David Fetterman. Listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere. On the 18th of April in 75, hardly a man is now alive who remembers that famous day and year. He said to his friend, "If the British march by land or sea from the town tonight, hang a lantern aloft in the belfry arch of the North Church Tower as a signal light. One if by land, and two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be, ready to ride and spread the alarm through every Middlesex village and farm, for the country folk to be up and to arm." Then he said, "Good night," and with a muffled oar, silently rowed to the Charleston shore. Just as the moon rose over the bay, where swinging wide at her moorings lay, the Somerset, British man of war, a phantom ship with each mast and spar, across the moon like a prison bar, and a huge black hulk that was magnified by its own reflection in the tide. Meanwhile, his friend, through alley and street, wanders and watches with eager ears, till in the silence around him he hears the muster of men at the barrack door, the sound of arms and the tramp of feet, and the measured tread of the grenadiers marching down to their boats on the shore. Then he climbed the tower of the old North Church, by the wooden stairs with stealthy tread, to the belfry chamber overhead, and startled the pigeons from their perch on the somber rafters that round him made, masses and moving shapes of shade. By the trembling ladder steep and tall, to the highest window in the wall, where he paused to listen and look down, a moment on the roofs of the town, and the moonlight flowing over all. Beneath in the churchyard lay the dead, in their night encampment on the hill, wrapped in silence so deep and still that he could hear like a sentinel's tread the watchful night wind as it went, creeping along from tent to tent and seeming to whisper, "All is well." A moment only he feels the spell of the place and the hour and the secret dread of the lonely belfry and the dead. For suddenly all his thoughts are bent on a shadowy something far away, where the river widens to meet the bay, a line of black that bends and floats on the rising tide, like a bridge of boats. Meanwhile, impatient to mount and ride, booted and spurred with a heavy stride, on the opposite shore walked Paul Revere. Now he patted his horse's side, now gazed at the landscape far and near, then impetuous stamped the earth, and turned and tightened his saddle girth. But mostly he watched with eager search the belfry tower of the old North Church, as it rose above the graves on the hill, lonely and spectral and somber and still. And lo, as he looks on the belfry's height, a glimmer and then a gleam of light. He springs to the saddle, the bridle he turns, but lingers and gazes till full on his sight a second lamp in the belfry burns. A hurry of hooves in a village street, a shape in the moonlight, a bulk in the dark, and beneath from the pebbles in passing a spark, struck out by a steed flying fearless and fleet, that was all. And yet through the gloom and the light, the fate of a nation was riding that night. And the spark struck out by that steed in his flight kindled the land to flame with its heat. He has left the village and mounted the steep, and beneath him tranquil and broad and deep is the mystic meeting the ocean and tides. And under the alders that skirt its edge, now soft on the sand, now loud on the ledge, is heard the tramp of his steed as he rides. It was 12 by the village clock when he crossed the bridge into Medford town. He heard the crowing of the cock and the barking of the farmer's dog, and felt the death of the river fog that rises after the sun goes down. It was 1 by the village clock when he galloped into Lexington. He saw the gilded weathercock swim in the moonlight as he passed, and the meeting house windows blank and bare gaze at him with a spectral glare, as if they already stood aghast at the bloody work they would look upon. It was 2 by the village clock when he came to the bridge in Concord town. He heard the bleating of the flock and the twitter of the birds among the trees, and felt the breath of the morning breeze blowing over the meadows brown. And 1 was safe and asleep in his bed. Who at the bridge would be first to fall? Who that day would be lying dead, pierced by a British musket ball? You know the rest in the books you have read, how the British regulars fired and fled, how the farmers gave them ball for ball from behind each fence and farmyard wall, chasing the redcoats down the lane, then crossing the fields to emerge again under the trees at the turn of the road, and only pausing to fire and load. So through the night rode Paul Revere, and so through the night went his cry of alarm to every Middlesex village and farm. A cry of defiance, and not of fear, a voice in the darkness, a knock at the door, and a word that shall echo forevermore. Forborne on the night wind of the past, through all our history, to the last, in the hour of darkness and peril and need, the people will waken and listen to hear the the hurrying hoofbeats of that steed and the midnight message of Paul Revere. End of poem. This recording is in the public domain.
Chapter 3.